Okay guys, here's the project of the day. It's a reproduction of a Charles Limbert number 251 Tabouret side table. It's got some interesting construction details like these long locking miter joints at the corner, angled cutout shape, a lifted shape at the bottom that gives the impression of legs, not to mention these beautiful corbels and the octagon top. We'll get started on this interesting little table, gluing up panels for the sides and the top. All right, so we'll need a few panels for our Limbert style tabouret side table. And we're basically gonna need four panels for the sides of the table. And then what we're gluing up here is just the small top. And it just needs to be about 17 inches square to start. And so we'll glue up a little piece with nice pretty figure on it, and we'll dress that out later at the planer. A couple small clamps, one on either side of the panel, helps to align things at the top, so you can go ahead and tighten your clamps up. We're always looking for a little bit of squeeze out at the joint line. Let us know we have good glue coverage. Then we'll add a couple more clamps for a total of five. And then just grab a board with a known straight edge and check the panel for flatness. That looks really good there. We'll let that dry for a few hours. Well, let's see how we did with some of these side panels. We'll pull the clamps off and take a look at the flatness of the panel here. Yeah, these look pretty good. I think just a skim pass through the planer will get these looking nice again. You want more treats, don't you? Okay. Even though these panels are still in somewhat of a rough state, they really have some nice courtesan figure, and you can tell they're going to be quite pretty panels once they're dressed out at the planer. Okay, let's go ahead and install this combination blade 40 tooth onto the Fusion F2, and we'll also take advantage of the riving knife. We'll slip that in the slot and press the handle down, and we'll be all ready to trim those panels to size. We'll slip the locking throat plate in place and be ready to go to work. So now that we've got the faces of all our panels cleaned up, we're ready to go ahead and cross cut one end for a square start, and then flip it over and we'll cross cut it to length. Just confirm that we're making nice square cuts before we batch out the rest of the panels. Right on the money. Crank the blade angle over to 5 degrees on the fast acting crank on the Fusion F2, and we'll lock that in place. Give yourself little cheater lines to remember which way the angle is oriented at both the top and the bottom of the panel. Okay, so we're gonna make a light skimming cut to angle the top and bottom of the panels here. Make sure to have a good sharp blade on your F2, as well as it's absolutely critical to have your riving knife installed. Okay, here we go. Hold the stock firmly against the fence with push paddles to control this cut. Set your fence to 23 1/4 for the final angled trimming pass. Flip the panel end for end and we'll complete that final trimming pass. Install a dado blade on your F2 saw, and a 5/8 inch dado stack will work fine for the size groove we're going to cut in the panels. Mark the point where your dado blade starts to rise up above the surface of the table. From this point to a stop block that you'll clamp to your table saw needs to be 7 1/4 inches. That's the length of the groove we need atop each panel. So we've got the blanks roughed out for our corbels, and the next step is to form a little stub tenon on the back edge where it will meet with the panel of the tabouret table. Here we go. With the same dado blade setup and sacrificial fence at the table saw, go ahead and raise the blade to about 1/4 inch, and we'll knock off the bottom of this tenon so it'll be blind where it intersects with the panels. Well, it may not look like much yet, but we've actually accomplished some key steps towards building our side table. It's really important to cut the bevels at the top and bottom of the panel while the sides are still straight and square. Likewise, you'll want to cut the groove at the top of the panel before you cut the angles on the side. The basic rule it boils down to is joinery before curves. Same applies with the corbel blanks. You want to cut that stub tenon before you cut the curved shape. Just makes everything easier to cut, and you can ensure your joinery looks good before you move on to the angles and the curves. You just checking the finish? You pre-finishing? Okay. Okay, to make the template to route the side panels, just make 2-inch strips of 1/2 inch thick MDF and lay that out along your layout lines and just attach it with some double-sided carpet tape. That plus a couple clamps at either end will hold it firmly in place and allow you to route out the patterns. Once you have your template made, go ahead and clamp it to your side panel work pieces and just lay out all the lines that are represented by the template. The angles along the sides, as well as the cutout and this lifted shape on the bottom. Then we'll need to attach the template to a workpiece with carpet tape. From there, we can just flush trim the edge of the panels. Well, there's probably lots of good ways to knock out these openings in the panels, but my favorite way is to use a 1/4 inch spiral bit and a guide bushing. That acts as a first step to just pop out these openings, almost using a router like a jigsaw. We'll make these cuts with multiple depth settings and several passes. Tackle this lower cutout in the same way. Only a couple steps remain to clean up these cutouts. The next will be a large diameter bearing guided bit To flush trim this opening, the final step will be switching over to a small diameter bit to get into the corners a little tighter. With the template still clamped to the workpiece, we've flipped the whole assembly over to finish that last trimming step in the corner. We've got our small diameter bit with the bearing on the tip, and we'll go ahead and clean out those inside corners. And just pop the template loose. Well, this is the challenging project, and it always feels good when the lock miters are done and you get to test out and see how you did. In this case, we've got long grain glue joints, and so this is going to be very strong once it's glued up, and this is just a friction fit, obviously, and even at that, you know, it'll hold the work pieces up, so we know we've got a good joint that'll be a gap-free joint once it's glued up. Burnish it a little bit with a screwdriver or ease it with a roundover bit, and it's just a beautiful way to join furniture panels. So one of the keys about the way that we routed this was we put the same joint on the left and right of each panel. And as a result, that one's gonna go here. We're only gonna have to clamp this in one direction. Basically, once this is all put together, clamps here and clamps here in the same direction are going to be enough to hold our project together. And the beauty of that is things won't be sliding around as we try to close our joints. And so we can kind of get a feel for it. Now this is with no clamping pressure, and I haven't really taken time to align my tops or anything, but I'm just giving it a quick look over to see how close our joints are. And I can already tell that with a little clamping pressure, these will pull together just fine. Here at the router table, we'll just ease over any sharp edges of these cutouts. Hey, before you get the glue out, just do a mock-up. Make sure the clamps can easily bring the project together without gaps. Save your cutoffs, by all means. You've got these angled shaped cutoffs when we originally built the panels. One side will be smooth and one side will be a little rougher bandsaw cut. Take the smooth side and put that up against the panels. You'll need that just in one direction, so you'll need four cauls overall, and that'll just greatly simplify the glue up. Well, the project table almost looks like a flower when it's laid open in this way, but it's a nice way to situate your parts so that we can get glue on all the mating surfaces before we clamp it together. If you can, you'd like to direct the squeeze out to the outside corner of the miter. Go a little light with the glue on this inside edge. We'd like to minimize squeeze out on the inside of the table. With glue applied to all the surfaces now, we'll just go ahead and work the parts together. The beauty of this whole system is you only have to clamp this table in one direction, and that's specifically because of the way that we routed the locking miter joint. Then just continue adding clamps and make sure that your miter is closing up tightly everywhere. Hopefully you won't have to empty the clamp rack because these joints are self-aligning. Just make sure the top of your panels stay flush as you add the last few clamps. With one of our corbels already cut and sanded to shape, we'll use that as a master template to mark the other three. We'll get that drawn out and finish the cuts at the bandsaw. Well, this is kind of a fun part. You get to test fit the corbels here, so we'll pop those in the groove that we've made and just set your height approximately where you want it, and then we'll just go ahead and clamp that corbel in place near the bottom. So obviously we need to trim the tip of the corbel so it matches the 5-degree pitch of the side panels, and for that we'll just set a straight edge across the top and mark the line where it intersects the corbel. Set the proper angle on your chop saw and go ahead and trim the top of the corbels to the correct angle. Well, we're gaining on it now. We've sanded the corbels and kind of eased the edges over at the router table, and now we've come to that point where it's just time to glue those corbels in place. And the really nice thing about making your corbels this way with a little stub tenon is that the part won't slide around in the glue as you go to clamp it in place. It's really simple to register the part, get it exactly where you want. In fact, all you need to focus on is just making this intersection flush right at the top of the table. We can go ahead and confirm that with a long straight edge. That looks good there. We'll go ahead and clamp it in place. Okay, so we've got these temporary 45 degree blocks mounted to our crosscut sled with a little bit of carpet tape. This will help to align our top as we go ahead and make those 45 degree cuts for our octagon shaped top. Okay, so at this point we have the finish applied and we're just about ready to complete this project. We just have to attach the top. And we're going to do that with a combination of pocket hole screws and figure eight fasteners. Well, you've got options when it comes to attaching the top. In this case, we're using a combination of 4 pocket hole screws and 4 figure eight fasteners to allow some wood movement. So we'll just start installing the top with the pocket hole screws. We'll get 4 of those set. And then we'll switch over to a Phillips driver and finish installing those figure eight fasteners. If you like this finish and want to use the same one on your project, check Laguna's YouTube channel for an ottoman project. That ottoman features the exact same finishing schedule. Well, there it is, guys. Nice little 251 Tabouret table that you can build in your own shop. I hope this is one you decide to tackle and build for yourself. Makes a beautiful little piece of furniture. Thanks for watching.